Hi, welcome everyone. My name is Sarah Carr, and I'm coordinator of the Coastal Marine Ecosystem-Based Management Tools Network, EBM Tools Network for short. And the EBM Tools Network is co-coordinated by NatureServe and OpenChannels.org. And we have Nick Wehner of OpenChannels.org here also co-moderating this webinar. We're very pleased today to have Susan Preston from Environment and Climate Change Canada on today to talk about completing and using ecosystem service assessment for decision making, an interdisciplinary toolkit for managers. So we're thrilled Susan can talk about the Ecosystem Services Toolkit today. And in just a minute, I'll turn it over to Susan. But before we do, I wanted to let you know how to ask questions. We will have a time at the end of the presentation, or at the end of the webinar, for question and answer with Susan. You can send Susan questions by typing the questions into the question panel of the user interface. So the part that says questions, go ahead and type your questions in. You can send your questions in throughout the presentation. We will generally hold most questions till the end, till the question and answer period. But if you had a quick clarifying question, such as what an acronym stands for, we might address that during the webinar. But in general, we'll hold. But we encourage you to send in your questions throughout the webinar. And there's no reason, as soon as a question occurs to you, not to go ahead and send it in. Okay, well, thank you, Susan. We so appreciate you being here today.
Thank you very much, Sarah, for hosting this webinar. I really appreciate the opportunity to talk about this Ecosystem Services Toolkit publication with as many people as we can, so that's great. As Sarah mentioned, I work as a senior analyst in Canada's Federal Department of Environment and Climate Change in the National Biodiversity Policy Division. So in this webinar, what I would like to do is to give an introduction to this technical guidance document. It was developed over the last few years through a collaboration of our federal, provincial, and territorial governments. I served as the lead author and overall coordinator of the project, and Kara Rods of Hearn was the leading co-author. And the project benefited significantly from written contributions and reviews by many colleagues in government, as well as on our external expert panel. So what I want to do today is to briefly explain why we developed the toolkit and for whom, and then spend a minute on the vision that oriented the whole project. But for most of this webinar, I want to describe the content and the features that we hope will make this a really practical resource in Canada, but elsewhere as well. And so I'll just kind of go right into it. So federal, provincial, and territorial governments in Canada all play a role in biodiversity conservation. And I understand that the EBM Tools Network has lots of members from Canada as well as internationally. So this is a little bit of a quickie primer here for those who aren't familiar with the setup in Canada. They collaborate, so the federal, provincial, territorial governments collaborate on shared objectives such as developing a national biodiversity strategy and national biodiversity goals and targets. Most of the authority for responsibility for land use falls within the jurisdiction of the provincial and territorial governments, but all levels of government work together to address issues such as things like invasive alien species, and they undertake national scale analyses such as the Canadian Ecosystem Status and Trends Report series and the Canadian Nature Survey. So recognizing the need to address ecosystem services in a wide range of decision contexts, a national committee of assistant deputy ministers and deputy ministers requested that staff develop practical guidance to help everyone understand how to include ecosystem services in policy, planning, and managing for all kinds of ecosystems. So we were directed to address four challenges. First, how to use a logical and defensible means of deciding whether an ecosystem service assessment is warranted and how to prioritize the ecosystem services to be assessed. And maybe what I'll do is just to make it less words for me, I'll just use ES as the acronym and then you'll know what I'm talking about. So the second thing, the second task that we had was that if you were to decide to proceed to do an ecosystem service assessment or some type of sub-analysis that would be part of that process, how to do it in a way that is defensible and broadly interdisciplinary, retaining the integrity of results derived from different disciplinary methods and bodies of theory without reducing all of the analysis to a single common metric. And thirdly, guidance on how to understand both what the results mean and what they do not mean and how to communicate that. Which is actually really pretty important. One of the things that I've found over the years in being involved in the ecosystem services field is that it's easy for people to make assumptions about what some of the results mean that may not entirely be totally substantiated. And finally, how to use this information in a wide range of decision contexts. So since this toolkit was going to be for a lot of people, and some of whom it was going to be quite new to them, the guidance needed to be very specific and very thorough, and so we took a very step-by-step approach. And so we started by reflecting on our mandate and core principles and developed a conceptual framework to guide us. And you see in this slide, this is adapted from the very well-known Haynes-Young and Poshkin framework that's been sort of circulating and being revised and reused over and over again for several years now. And after several iterations ourselves, this is where we landed, knowing that our potential audience would have quite a varied familiarity with ecosystem services and different facets of the whole ecosystem service process. We wanted to really be clear about a few things that to us in this toolkit, the concept of ecosystem services is meant to demonstrate the human dependence on healthy ecosystems and the implications of human activity in the environment, and that taking the ecological, sociocultural, health, and economic aspects of ES into consideration in any decision process that results in effects on the environment is very likely to improve outcomes for both the environment and society. And that also by illustrating how ecosystem components are connected, this framework and therefore the toolkit can help to reveal how a proposed activity or decision might impact the supply of ES. So in addition to the processes of ES production and benefit distribution, the framework recognizes the role of management and governance in affecting these processes, as well as the broader social and natural drivers of change, which you see as we're sort of going across the top bars in the graphic, and both the direct and indirect that influence how ES are produced and managed, and so we cycle back around in this continuous loop. So based on that framework, we developed the content and reorganized it a few times, but ultimately organized it as shown in the graphic table of contents to the right of this slide. And so what I'll do is over the remaining slides, I'm just going to sort of go through fairly quickly each one of the sections that you see here. And I should note also that in its present form, the toolkit is an interactive PDF file. It's freely downloadable in French and English, and the URLs are provided on the last slide at the end of the presentation. There is interest in turning it into a web-based tool. We just haven't gotten to that point yet. But also, even in its current format, we do consider it a green or a living document and look forward to updating it based on feedback from early adopters and pilot projects. And so having said that, I should note that it was published at the end of February this year. And so to start, though, you can see that on the left side of the graphic, there are three chapters and then a suite of 10 tool tabs with numerous features to aid in use and a complete list of works cited, of course. And one of the major innovations in the toolkit is this set of 9 practical worksheets that are indicated in the lower right corner of the graphic. And they're to be used in conjunction with the guidance in chapter 2, which is the 6 steps that you see in the blue box on the top right of the graphic. So I'll just go on and look at some of these sections in a little bit more detail. So this is the top half of that graphic. After addressing essential foundations in chapter 1, chapter 2 lays out the core actions in a 6-step approach. Chapter 3 illustrates how the knowledge of ES can be incorporated into procedures common to each of several policy decision contexts. And we worked really hard at trying to keep it as concise and brief as possible while still being as informative as possible. And, you know, trying to find that balance for, especially for government analysts and contractors that are often hired to do analysis for government departments and agencies. We tried a few different ways of organizing the information, and I'd have to say really thanks go to our federal, provincial, territorial task force members and reviewers. I think that the final approach that you'll see here in this long slide does actually succeed at helping people to maintain clarity, considering the really vast amount of information that's here. So chapter one then sets out the foundations. It illustrates the utility of ES assessment for a wide range of policy-related activities, with examples ranging from flood control to freshwater provision. We introduce the ES typology chosen for the toolkit, but note that the guidance can easily be adapted to use with other typologies. We chose to use the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment and just worked in a couple of the things that are different in the TEAB typology because these are well known, and also because they inform an awful lot of the existing published and grade literature in this field that would be needed to complete any analyses or assessments that are being done now. And so in addition, for resource-strapped government agencies, we wanted to use a typology that was simple enough to work with existing indicator sets as much as possible, and yet hopefully sophisticated enough to capture the breadth of ecosystem services. So then after the typology, the chapter introduces the conceptual analytical framework that you just saw and makes the case for ensuring that broad interdisciplinarity, for example, by laying out how different disciplines and their diverse theories and methods bring different perspectives that each make important contributions to this field of analysis. And then chapter one closes with advice on how to determine whether or not an ES assessment is advisable or warranted for a given situation and how to prioritize those ES. And so that's what I mentioned earlier. That was the first one of our mandated tasks in this. And I'll come back to that again when we look at the worksheets, and I'll show you how we approach that. And I'll just note too that the toolkit incorporates a number of what I'll call special features. And since they start in chapter one, I'm just going to take a moment to show you a couple of quick slides that have examples. So in this one, you see an example of an example box, and we use these throughout all three chapters. And they're set off with sort of special formatting with this bold arrow. And the example here is about a policy tool for analyzing wetlands in the province of Alberta. And so that's one example of a special feature. And this slide here, what you see on the left are three hyperlinked FAQs. And there are 45 of these in all and positioned in thematic groups after each major section in the first two chapters. The tip box on the right is another graphic feature that we use. This this kind of goes back to what I was saying before about trying to organize the information in a way that helps people keep everything straight. The tip boxes have content that's an aside to the core content on the page. And so in this one, for example, it explains how to use the FAQs because these are the first three. And then all the answers to the FAQs are linked in Tool Tab 8. And then at the end of each question, there's a link back to the chapter position where the question sits, so users don't have to worry about losing their spot. This slide shows some examples of three different key message boxes from three different places in the toolkit. And again, it's sort of a tool that we use for trying to prioritize some of the message and overarching points that we wanted to be sure that readers would see. So for example, these point to, for example, the importance of recognizing that different disciplines use some of the same core terms and language to mean actually very different things. So it's important for practitioners to come to a common understanding before launching into the analysis. And also recognizing that a lot of people's familiarity with ecosystem services is connected to economic valuation studies. And a lot of people may not be familiar with the biophysical sciences and social sciences that need to be involved. We sort of give special attention to a discussion of different ways of understanding values and different approaches to valuation in a separate tool tab, which is, you know, pointed to in the chapter here. So it's tool tab 6 and it's associated tool tab 7 are mentioned in early chapters because the tool tabs are at the end of the document. So chapter two explains how to complete ES assessments for a range of needs. This is the basically the instructions chapter for how to complete ES assessment and analyses. And it walks users through the six steps that we've used. And these are similar, but not quite the same as the six steps that you'll see in things like TEEB. We really needed to orient it in a way that also addressed those priority areas for us in terms of the broad interdisciplinarity and our mandated tasks. So this is a quick reference guide that appears very early in chapter two to each of the six steps to help users orient themselves before they start into the chapter. At a general level, these are informed by lessons learned from the UN Millennium Ecosystem Assessment. But as I noted, they're also sort of tied to our mandate. And so you can see from this how specific tools are connected to specific activities in the different steps. So for example, in step three, when you need to start thinking about what indicators you'll use to populate the cascade diagram in worksheet five, which is in tool tab four, you'll also need to review the tables of indicators in tool tab five. So it's set up so that the how-to chapter stays focused on instructions, and then you go to the relevant tools for things like more details, explanations and advice, lists of indicators, worksheets, and things like that. So this slide illustrates some of the other organizational features. At the top, you'll see a progress tracker that's inserted at key intervals to remind users of what they will have accomplished to that point. And it may advise, as this one does, that this would be a key moment to consult with senior managers or the client. And also, just below that, you'll see an overview box. And an overview box is placed at the start of each new step to orient users to sort of what's coming up next, including what key tools they're going to need to use. And here, this is also just to show a couple of other sort of features. The little at the top in the center there, I hope you can see it, this little colored arrow icon tells users basically that the text that it's adjacent to is referring to an iterative activity so that they should be prepared to come back to it with new information as they progress through the work. The second feature here is showing how the links to the worksheets are integrated. So you'll see that on the right-hand side about halfway down. We originally had both the guidance and the tools together, but reviewers found that it just became too confusing, so we separated them out. And so the guidance on the step-by-step activity is kept at a steady pace, and users don't get disoriented by navigating between activities and explanations and tools. And they can link to the individual worksheets and back again to the chapter, just like with the FAQs. And so just to illustrate this, if you were to click on the link in the right column above to worksheet two, it would take you to the instruction page for the worksheet and to the worksheet itself. So this slide shows a portion of the instructions and a portion of worksheet two. And so there's guidance here for each of the 10 columns and in this worksheet. The worksheets vary quite a bit in their format, and it's really all about the worksheets ask the users very specific questions that they need to answer in order to move through the steps. And so that essentially by filling in each of the nine worksheets, you're essentially completing your assessment. And of course you can choose, we give some guidance in chapter two about how to maybe strategically choose only certain steps or activities that you may want to do without doing a complete assessment. And so that's always a possibility too. So there's a lot more that I could say about chapter two, but given the amount of time that we have, I'm going to just kind of keep moving through. But I should also just note that slide, worksheet two, is the one that is the focus of the activities on how to determine if an ES assessment is what you want to be doing, and if it is, how to prioritize the ES to be focusing on. So chapter three starts off by briefly reflecting on what it means to mainstream ecosystem services. And we offer advice about considerations, ES considerations and or analysis, how these can be incorporated and where relevant into the existing protocols and procedures for each of 11 common policy and decision or management contexts affecting the environment. And so these are set up actually like standard format fact sheets with 2 to 3 pages for each, and each one explains the relevance of ES to that policy activity and then offers suggestions about entry points for ES. And provides an example, as you see on the lower half of this slide, and some additional information sources. So about this matter of entry points, first I'll just show you this slide. This is the list of the different decision and policy contexts that the chapter is built around. We chose these, certainly there are others, we chose these because they're all common to upper tiers of government. And I think it's probably the case that by going through these, you could learn really from the content in the chapter how to decide what the optimal entry points are for considering ES in other policy relevant areas as well, just sort of based on the way that this is set up. And the point of this is that protocols and procedures in every policy area are typically already entrenched in regulations or at least through formal high-level guidance. And so this can be seen as a barrier when we're trying to introduce new concepts and new approaches, and changing these processes can really be time consuming or not even possible. So we have to work with the existing protocols and practices and processes and with their practitioners to show how ES can legitimately be incorporated. And a key consideration I should mention there too is enabling language. Or terminology in these protocols and procedures and guidelines that are used. While they probably in most cases don't all yet use the term ecosystem services, they may refer to things like nature's benefits to society, natural capital, use values and non-use values, public interest, human well-being, natural infrastructure, or other terms that really could be addressed through an ES lens. And so they open the door really to including ES considerations or evidence. So this is back to this question about entry points that I mentioned. So if you look at this generically, there are typically a series of stages or steps in each policy or decision or management protocol. And even though individual government agencies and jurisdictions will have their own nuances in how they do these, there are general common steps that we can work with. And each stage corresponds loosely with opportunities to introduce some facet of ES, whether it's general considerations or specific data or analysis. And the nature of the ES consideration may have to do, for example, with ecosystem dynamics in relation to a decision or action, may have to do with how people are being affected or are affecting the flow of ES, the ways that ES can support infrastructure needs or the values associated with ES in economic terms or in sociocultural terms or health metrics. There are many different aspects of ES that can help to make better decisions. So now I want to take a few minutes and again, mindful of the time to sort of introduce the tools in the tool tab. This is the lower half of the what's inside graphic on that table of contents. And I'm just going to show you a few more screen captures to illustrate the contents of some of the tools. So tool tab one, and I'll just go through them in order. Tool tab one is a detailed list of ES descriptions with examples. So in chapter one, we provide a sort of a one-page chart. In tool tab one, that's fleshed out into a multi-page chart with a lot more detail. And again, we find that people are finding this helpful because while there are some ecosystem services that everybody is you know pretty familiar with, there are others that people are not quite sure when they see just the name of it, what it actually means. Tool tab two contains 7 one-page explanations of essential issues that practitioners and managers should understand at the outset, at least from our point of view. And so you see on this contents page, they're linked into the tool where you can get the details. On tool tab 3, now as far as I know, tool tab 3 is actually quite unique as the first advice of its kind to Canadian governments on ES analysis involving Indigenous communities. And we are really very fortunate that anthropologist Terry Satterfield contributed some really valuable text to this section. And I'm also actually, I should note, I'm happy to note that in the meantime, additional draft guidance has been developed for the IPBES. For those of you who may or may not be involved, the UN Intergovernmental Science Policy Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services by their task force on Indigenous and local knowledge, and that's available online. So it's, I think that we're starting to see some good resources there for working with Indigenous communities in this particular subject area. Tool tab 4 contains 9 practical worksheets. You saw a little bit of worksheet 2 for completing activities in the steps in chapter 2. And so they are designed to be used together with the instructions in chapter 2 and with other tools. And you're always directed to where you need to go. You don't have to sort of try to figure it out for yourself. So this shows how this is even a linked table of contents with a very short description for each of the worksheets. And we're also getting pretty good feedback already at the first workshop that Kara gave on this. There was a PhD student who'd been working on this. On ecosystem services, who commented when she saw worksheet 1 that she'd been trying to sort out what were the right questions she should be asking for quite some time, and here they all were, all laid out neatly in worksheet 1, which is a nice affirmation that we're providing a useful service. Tool tab 5 focuses on indicators that can be used to carry out assessments. Has 2 tables. The first one explains 11 broad types or conceptual categories of indicators. And the second is an 8-page table listing specific examples of both biophysical indicators and human benefits indicators for each type of ecosystem service. And we pulled that together from many different published sources. So it just becomes a good resource. Tool tab 6, I mentioned this earlier. This is a 20-page resource explaining the differences between and the uses for both economic valuation and sociocultural valuation. And this is among the very few published resources that explain sociocultural approaches for ecosystem services. And the only one I know of that discusses the nuts and bolts of both the economic and the sociocultural together. And it does so in an easy to compare format. And it also addresses what I often see is sort of a common misperception that cultural ecosystem services and cultural values are interchangeable, and why the distinction between those is quite important for analysis. And then that leads into tool tab 7, which is a compendium of data sources, analysis methods, and tools. And this is a series of 40 fact sheets with introductory information about these things. And it's another innovation, I think, in the ES assessment resources. And it was sort of a happy coincidence that after we had more than half of them drafted, the values compendium, if you're familiar with this, this is an initiative from GIZ. And their compendium was introduced online, and they also had clearly figured out that there was a need to have fact sheets. And we have very similar subheadings, so they kindly gave us permission to put hyperlinks to the fact sheets that they had done already that we hadn't yet got written, so that we didn't have to write them, which was quite handy. And this just shows the headings of the last three tools and the list of sources cited. So you've seen how the 45 different FAQs are incorporated into the chapters, and the answers are all in tool tab 8. Tool tab 9 is the glossary, tool tab 10, bibliographic reference list, particularly of studies that have been done on sites in Canada. It's already outdated, actually. It's only a year since we added to it, or less than a year. But the amount of literature that's being published in this field now is, as you well know, quite astronomical. And ensuring that the toolkit is a high quality technical resource based on expert literature really was a top priority for us. And so the last section is the 21-page linked reference list of sources cited. And so it took us a few years to pull this together. During that time, as I mentioned, we saw a huge increase in the peer-reviewed literature on the subject of ecosystem services, and that really the widespread uptake of this concept by NGOs and agencies, and also by governments now. And it's been reassuring to see that the toolkit has really sort of remained consistent with some of the major directions that thinking seems to be moving in, for example, with this broader interdisciplinarity, incorporating the biophysical, soft sciences, social sciences, economics, health sciences, indigenous environmental knowledge. And we're also pleased to have been able to take the time to work through some of the really complicated issues and to address them alongside those practical steps for assessment. And as I wrap up, I'd again like to thank Sarah and the EBM Tools Network for hosting this webinar today, and the many people who helped to create the Ecosystem Services Toolkit, and members of our National Task Force and the Toolkit Subcommittee, dozens of additional government colleagues, all of whom participated in discussions and reviews at every stage of the process, our senior executives for requesting and supporting and publishing this work. And I'm equally grateful to our external expert panel members and contributors for their engagement in workshops and reviews. It's really been an honor to work with all of these fine people, and there are so many without whom this vision really would not have materialized, and maybe none more so than Kara Rousseff-Hearn. So I have lots and lots of people to express thanks to for their contributions to this work. So here you can see the URL to access the toolkit in English and in French. And we really encourage everyone who uses it for any reason to send feedback in writing to me, and that will assist greatly in our development of version 2.0. So my email address is there. I just thank you very much for your interest in this webinar.
Great. Thank you so much, Susan. This looks like an extremely valuable tool and with so much work going into it and really well organized. So that's fantastic. I wanted to remind everyone how to ask questions. You can type the questions into the question panel of the user interface, and then I'll relay them to Susan. And there was one question about will the slides be shared. We will post a recording of the webinar on openchannels.org in the next couple hours. If you're interested in getting the link to that, you can email me. It's the email address that the webinar announcements are coming from. So it's ebmtools@hsr.org, and I can send you the link if you want to see it, watch things again, or share with others. Okay. One question that came in during the webinar is, How do the tools and the guide address cumulative effects, and does the tool work at all to assess cumulative effects?
That's a really excellent question, and it is certainly one of those very hot topics these days, I think probably in many parts of the world. The toolkit doesn't provide specific advice about cumulative effects. However, I think the point is made, and I think many people appreciate that, taking an ecosystem services lens at looking at what's going on in decisions over time across space, the ecosystem services lens really facilitates being able to take into account cumulative effects. And in Tool Tab 2, one of the little sort of fact sheets that's in there has a graphic that I actually adapted with permission from I think it's the ARES conceptual framework, and it's a graphic, it's a schematic diagram basically that shows in a landscape the interconnectedness of you know, the places where ecosystem services are produced, and that they travel through, and where people benefit from them, and how different activities can either enhance or impede the flow of those ecosystem services. And it sort of shows that that complexity. In addition, we have in one of the FAQs, there is a schematic diagram that Kara developed that also emphasizes this interconnectedness. And I think the text that supports both of those pieces helps to perhaps contribute to the guidance for thinking about cumulative effects in this context.
Okay, great. Thank you, Susan. I was curious, like, to what extent the guide is recent, has been published recently, to what extent there's been sort of been field testing of the tools, and then just talk about future field testing of people using it. What sort of relationship do you want to have with people who are using the guide? Just know that they're doing it. Is anyone able to work with you on any of these aspects? What are you interested in hearing from people who are using the tools and the guide in the field?
Thanks. Those are all excellent questions. So I don't know if it would be correct to say yes to everything. Where we are, I definitely want to, at minimum, hear from people who are using it for any size of consideration. Doesn't even have to be in a whole full assessment project. If they just are using because they found one tool in there or some piece of advice that's useful, I would really, really value the you know, sort of hearing about their experience, what people find worked really well, what they also found, you know, they were working away at something, all of a sudden there was a gap that the toolkit didn't help them with. What was that? Because then maybe that's something we can address in version two. And in terms of relationships with people who are working on it, certainly I think with regard to the content of the toolkit, if there's something that's unclear, people are struggling to understand, you know, get in touch with me. As you know, there's no shortage of literature out there on this subject, and you could probably easily find answers anywhere. But feel free, you know, to follow up with me with any questions. In terms of sort of road testing and pilot projects, so far, you know, I mean, we've been doing things like trying out the worksheets in workshop settings initially. To see how people are responding to them. That's gone quite well. I recently got an email earlier this summer from the City of Ottawa, who has indicated that they're using the toolkit for a planning process that they were undergoing, which was really great news. I didn't even realize they had it. So that's really nice. And some organizations working with municipalities in different parts of Canada were quite interested in looking at how they could use some of the guidance in here to help inform work they were doing on natural assets planning. And I know there are folks in different parts of the federal government and different provinces who are, you know, wanting to sort of work through figuring out how can they apply it in their particular situation. So I'll be giving a series of workshops and things with our colleagues in Canada's federal, provincial, and territorial governments to help answer some of those questions and hopefully sort of facilitate the courage to launch into using it more fully.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, that's great. I do have a question about costs. Like, does the guide sort of address costs of doing ecosystem service work? Are there any sort of case studies that are presented that address any issues of cost for doing this work and at various levels? Because obviously it could be scaled from nothing to everything. So.
Well, and your last sentence really says it all. I think, again, one of the things about ecosystem services work analysis is that it can be scaled from, you know, somebody sitting at their desk doing all of their analysis using existing literature to going out into the field and, you know, having to do primary research over, you know, at the dramatic end of the spectrum, something quite large. So there isn't really, I think, a standard you know, sort of that you could anticipate how much it would cost. I think it works more almost in the inverse, which is to say, when you are planning, and the first couple of steps in chapter two include advice about that sort of planning your assessment from the administrative side of things, and sort of helping to sort out what are the resources you're going to need to be able to do this. And so there's a worksheet that goes along with that, but we provide the questions that you need to ask to help you to know what to be able to figure out for your case and your situation and what your needs are, what kind of resources you're likely to need.
Okay, great. Susan, and that's all we have for questions, because hopefully people are all looking through the toolkit right now. So thank you so much. We so appreciate you coming on to speak about this and for doing this work. And you've provided your information, and Nick also posted a link to one of the versions of the guide. Okay, actually, no, a question just came in, so we'll go ahead and address this question. It said, great effort and a lot of work. How do we overcome the dilemma of managing and exploiting simple individual ecosystem goods and services, which often leads to a cascade of indiscriminate and unintended negative consequences for the entangled non-target ecosystem services? Is there truly a way to provide a successful balance other than preservation according to nature's design?
I'm trying to make sure I understand what's being asked.
How do you avoid a focus on individual ecosystem goods and services? And
Okay, so that, you know, I'm really glad that question was asked, because I feel very strongly, personally and professionally, that that's actually a really important issue. And that's largely a really key part of why Worksheet 2 is designed the way that it is. Because the advice that goes with it basically is, even though you may think you know which ecosystem services you want to focus on, it's really important to do this worksheet that looks at all possible ecosystem services that may be affected by a decision that is about to be made, that is what's, you know, motivating doing this analysis work, to identify all of the possible ecosystem services that could be affected, the extent to which they could be affected, what those dynamics are between them. And then that helps you to sort of come out the other end of that worksheet and say, oh gosh, we didn't even realize this. There are, you know, 7 or 8 different ecosystem services here that are actually, you know, likely to be strongly affected by this decision, and we're going to need to address those in whatever path forward we do, and including starting by doing a more fulsome assessment of them.
Okay. Great. Thank you, Susan. And some other thanks coming in through the comments for the great presentation and for doing all this work. So again, thank you. Nick posted the link to the toolkit in the chat, and hopefully you guys saw that. And then you can, and if you have any problems, you can go ahead and get in touch with Susan or myself, and we can route you in the right place. Okay, so thank you, everyone, and thank you so much, Susan. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much for making the time.
Yes. Now, everyone, have a great rest of your day.